All right. Good morning. Good morning. It is good to be with you. Yeah, there's so many things going through my mind within this past week. I arrived here Tuesday night, and this is a place I call home. I was born and raised right here in Wanyoro. So, yeah, right down the street. No, not from here, but I think we're Pastor Joy. So, I haven't been back since '85. So, Korea has changed somewhat since 1985. And I could have never imagined a world filled with so many non-Koreans in Korea. I still remember, I think it was in Wanyoro's Haga, there was one American in our neighborhood, and we thought he was like the unicorn. Like, we tried to like sneak a peek at him, yeah, whenever he was walking around. Oh my gosh, there he is! There he is, you know, he exists, and here you are. This is, you know, like I'm trying to like create space mentally to like process you all in Korea, and it's hard. I'm like, why would non-Koreans ever go to Korea? Like, it's Korea, and you know, here you are. So, the food is good, yes, absolutely, and there are a lot of good things, but it's just. Is that enough reason? Is it? I don't know, you know. But I am thankful. I've had some time to think about this retreat. And, you know, in conversation with Pastor Joel, talking about his church, just to see really God's kingdom, which is so much bigger than our national identity, even ethnic identity, and how God uses different people to pour into his body. It's a beautiful thing, and we need other voices, other perspectives, because a lot of times you can create blind spots and not even know it, right? And you just think, this is how we do faith, how we do church. And then here comes somebody else, and they're like, no, it's actually bigger than that. And you're like, huh, that's good. So I'm really thankful for all of you being in Korea, you know, doing what you do. And I know God is using you to accomplish that very purpose. So thank you. Okay, I think that's it. All right, let me pray for us. And we'll start. God, we give you thanks for all the ways that you remind us that you really are good. You give us the gift of friends, gift of laughter, community that we can come together. A weekend where we can set apart some time to dive into your word and to draw closer to each other, various expressions of your glory and beauty we see in people, but also even your word, a window into your own heart as we search the depth of who you are and seek to be faithful in living our lives for you. Pray that you would allow this weekend to be faithful. I know it's a short time, but Lord, that you would. Not answers, give us questions that would lead to a deeper understanding of you and the calling that you have given to us as your people, called to live out this unique, special calling, at least for now here in Seoul. In Jesus' name, amen. As a way of framing up the talk, I wanted to talk about something Tim Keller talks about. You guys know, familiar with Tim Keller? He's like the bishop of the PCA. We got Mark Dever in Washington, D.C., who's the bishop of Southern Baptist. And we got Tim Keller in New York. And, you know, he talks about a healthy church. What makes a healthy church? You need three components, right? You need one, piety, spiritual disciplines. You cannot get away from that, okay? Regardless of what the cultural climate is, without carving out times where you can be with the Lord in deep prayer, meditation, reflection, exercising solitude, and growing deep in your affection for the Lord, you cannot grow spiritually. So you need pietism, but you also need theology. You can't just be all heart. You sort of need to know a thing or two about the scripture and theology and so forth. But you also need the third component, which I would call cultural engagement. Right? We have been called into the church, but then we're then sent out back into the world to take what is so good and beautiful about God and bring it in the forefront, in the trenches of our workplace and the relationships that we find ourselves in. So in order for us to be a healthy church, you need all those components moving simultaneously, right? And really pulling you into sometimes difficult places where you don't have answers, especially on the cultural front. As you think about how fast things are moving, right? And here you are, you say you believe in the word that is 2,000 years old. You worship a God who came in flesh 2,000 years ago. And so you are, in one sense, the gatekeepers of tradition, yet you're supposed to take that and translate it into modern day 21st century world. So how do you take something that seems archaic, outdated, old, and apply it in a relevant way that makes sense to someone who knows nothing about this? And so you got to be really creative in taking the gospel and framing it and packaging it in ways that is not only palatable, but attractive. And that's the homework for the church. How do we take the gospel, and simply banging it over people's head isn't going to work? I tried it. Anyone else try it? Like, you know, I've been on the metro a few times here, and there are some faithful believers preaching the gospel right there on the train. I praise God for their faith and their obedience. But I wonder, like, how much of that actually distances them from all the would-be audience who would say, hey, that sounds interesting, let's talk about that. But if you're sitting there at rush hour preaching the gospel, and a lot of it is like this, like fire and brimstone undertone, right? It's like, what, you know what I mean? You lose credibility, you lose audience, and I don't know how far you get in that sort of endeavor. So we got to do well in packaging the gospel in a way that resonates with people. And that's something that we want to do in our time together as we think about the larger question of who are we as culture makers, and where does our work, primarily work, fall in that spectrum? Because work is one of many things that comprise our culture. And we understand culture a lot of times to be ethnic, right, or national culture, but there are a lot of subcultures that we operate out of. Believe it or not, you wear lots of hats. In your work culture, you know how to swim in that water really well. The moment you get home, in your home culture, you put on a different hat. In the church culture, you put on a different hat. And we are very fluent as we go in and out of these cultures, but this is where we sort of run into a wall, right? How do we do the Christian thing here in this world? What does it mean to be salt and light? So that's what we're going to try to do. And before we get any further, if you're the note-taking type, I want you to write a couple of questions down. One, what is the hardest thing about living your faith, living out your faith in your workplace? What is the hardest thing? And it doesn't have to be the hardest thing, but it could be a handful of things that you find to be difficult. It could be theological. I don't know. I don't have all the theological bearings, so I'm not sure what cultural engagement in my workplace looks like. It could be that. It could be practical. I don't know how my theology informs my practice. And it could be maybe a compromise. We, like Pastor Joel said, I pastor a church in Washington, D.C., and many of them are chief of staffs for, you know, senators and congressmen. And they often feel like they got to do things that seem like a compromise, like a moral compromise. What do you do with that as you wade into this murky waters of, like, political world and living that out? And I'm sure for some of you in your workplace, you find yourself in that similar spot often. So what does that mean, right, to live out your faith in that setting? Maybe for some of you, it's like relational. Being a Christian has labeled me to be this weird person, right? And everyone just, they dislike me. They just assume that I'm a certain way. So maybe, I don't know what your struggle is, but you can write some of those things down. And I'll say this, and I do apologize for all these prefaces here. I try to make it into a seminar, but I'm like, yeah, no, I want to make it into a preaching the word too. So I went and synthesized these two, which means it's going to be longer and we'll track faster. Okay, so as we go through this, if you have questions, just write them down. And afterwards, we have Q&A. And I'm here. You know, I don't know how to get out. so I'm here. I tried that this morning, and I ran into a pack of wild dogs. I think that was a sign, like, you better stay. So, I'm here. And if you want to talk about any of this stuff and sort of drop down into your particular specific work situation, then I would love to do that. Not that I have answers, but at least I could give you some sort of framework to operate out of, certainly a theological one. And I trust that it would be beneficial. Okay, let's turn to Psalm 90. Psalm 90, and we're going to read the whole psalm. It's a lengthy psalm. It's a beautiful psalm, often used for various occasions. Psalm written by Moses. And I'm going to ask someone to read it for us. Anyone? Psalm 90? Yes. Thank you.
Lord, you have been our dwelling place in all generations. Before the mountains were brought forth, forever you have formed the earth and the world. From everlasting to everlasting, you are God. You return man to dust and say, return, O children of man. For a thousand years in your sight are but as yesterday when it is past, or as a watch in the night. You sweep them away as with a flood. They are like a dream, like grass that is renewed in the morning. In the morning it flourishes and is renewed. In the evening it fades and withers. For we are brought to an end by your anger, by your wrath and your dismay. You have set our iniquities before you, our secret sins in the light of your presence. For all our days pass away under your wrath. We bring our years to an end like a sigh. The years of our life are 70, or even by reason of strength, 80. Yet their span is but toil and trouble. They are soon gone and they fly away. Who considers the power of your anger and your wrath according to the fear of you? So teach us to number our days, that we may get a heart of wisdom. Return, O Lord, how long? Have pity on your servants. Satisfy us in the morning with your steadfast love, that we may rejoice and be glad all our days. Make us glad for as many days as you have afflicted us, and for as many years as we have seen people. Let your work be shown to your servants, and your glorious power to the children. Let the favor of our Lord our God be upon us, and establish the work of our hands upon us. Yes, establish the work of our hands.
Amen. Can we pray one more time? God, we come humbly before your word, and we ask that you would allow your favor to rest upon us now. That even though we may have more questions than answers as we think about cultural engagement, what it means to understand work from a biblical standpoint, I pray that we would do so from the starting point of deep love for Jesus and your word. And we pray that you would do that now. Lord, speak to us. We need your word. We need Christ, the incarnate word, to come and give shape to our faith. In Jesus' name, amen. Robert Frost once said, the brain is a wonderful thing. It starts working the moment you get up in the morning and does not stop until you get to the office. Work is one of those things we love to hate, at least for some of us, right? And part of that is due to our lack of theology of work. We just don't understand how we are supposed to understand work. A lot of us, we assume that work is the consequence of fall. Like in the garden, we roamed around, we played, we ate, we named animals, and then we sinned, and now we got to clock in and clock out, 9 to 5, dang it. But as we see it in the scripture, work actually existed before fall, okay? Adam was a gardener. Imagine this, we have paintings of Adam, this glorified dude, you know, chiseled, and we think, Adam, yes, but he had dirt under his nails from working in the garden. Paul, the famous apostle, he was a tent maker. He had calloused hands. Jesus, our Lord and Savior, he was a carpenter. And, you know, he spent most of his earthly life learning his trade. How do you work with this wood? How do you work with that wood? What does it mean to bend it this way and nail that? And that was 30 years of his life. All that to say, we are created for work. And by work, I don't mean just our career. I want to expand that more to say that it is our general calling, okay? Work is our general calling to exercise our gifts. And we are all gifted. There's no such thing as gift of no gifts, okay? We all are gifted, okay? So we are called to exercise our gifts and to utilize the resources God has put, okay, entrusted to us, be it time, be it our intellectual capital, be it our passion, our experience, our network of people. It sounds like that seems to be an important thing here in Korea. It really depends on like who you know to get into where, same as DC. So we're called to exercise our gifts and to utilize our resources to seek the common good of all people, not just me and the people I know and I love, but really the general public. Common grace for common good, as we say. And we are called to do this in different domains we operate out of, in our workplace, in our home, in our church, in our community, and so on and so forth. And there is a deep connection between our work and our humanity. Just talk with those people who have been out of work for some time. They don't say, I love it. I love the fact that I don't have to do anything for so long. But they feel like they're missing out on something because they're not engaged in meaningful work. There's a deep connection between work and humanity. Our longing for meaningful work really is part of God's good design. Theodore Roosevelt once said this about work. He said, far and away, the best prize that life has to offer is the chance to work hard at work worth doing. Common grace. To understand the importance of work, not just any work, but meaningful work. Work that requires really just us pouring into it. There is deep satisfaction and joy that we derive from this. Where do we get this? What's the genesis, the origin of this? Well, in Genesis 1:1, we read, in the beginning, God created. He worked. God created. Now, we know he rested eventually, but he created. He worked. And as God's image bearers, we are created for work. And not just any work, but enduring work, lasting work, meaningful work that will not only stand the test of time, but it will contribute to common good. And Jesus appeals to this in Matthew chapter 7 as he wraps up the Sermon on the Mount. As he drives this thing home, he uses a metaphor that he assumes that everyone understands. He says, do not build your house on sand that's going to come and go. But build your house on a rock. That's going to be here. It's going to last. And he doesn't provide commentary to say, well, here are the reasons why you should do that. But he leaves that at that because he understands that we all long for something meaningful and something lasting. In our fallen world, however, many of us, in our honest moments, I think we fear that our work will not matter. And we hear this all the time in surveys and in polls. Nothing is more demoralizing than meaningless work that you punch in and punch out and it's not doing anything. You can only collect a paycheck for so long before you say, no thanks. I got to do something that I really enjoy, that I'm passionate about. You see, we long for the arc of our work to extend beyond our life. Okay? Psychologist Eric Erickson agrees. He talks about a latter stage of life called generativity versus stagnation, at which point, as aging adults about to enter into the twilight of our life, we long to leave an imprint, a footprint in this world that will make a difference so that our next generation, be it our children and so forth, will be able to point to it and say, we are so thankful for that person. We are so thankful for that contribution in this world. There is something in us, and this is not just for Christians who understand the kingdom, but just people in the world. They understand the importance of leaving meaning behind. And some of you may be asking, well, didn't God actually disapprove of the Tower of Babel back in Genesis 11? Because they seem to be doing the same thing. You know, here they are coming together, okay, to build this tower in the middle of the city. And God didn't like that a whole lot. In fact, he judged it and dispersed people and scattered them across the face of the earth. Now, without going too much into the theology of this, let me just say the Tower of Babel, in short, was a declaration of independence from God. It was their way of saying, God, thanks, but no thanks. We got this figured out. Because that gap between heaven and earth, which was created on the second day of creation, was good. God saw it and said, it is good. And man said, he saw it and said, it is not good. We're going to figure this out and make a way to heaven. So they come together to build this tower, and they say, we will make a way to heaven. We will save ourselves. We will become like God. It's an echo of what the serpent said. If you eat of this fruit, you will be like God. And that's why God disapproved of that. You see, nowhere in Genesis 11 does God actually rebuke the people for wanting to make something that reached beyond their generation. And here, even in Genesis chapter 11, we see the gospel foreshadowed. God came down and judged the people, and much later he will come down again. He will take up permanent residence among us. And rather than scattering people, he will gather all manner of people for himself. How? By dying on the cross. In fact, I would say Psalm 90 says the very desire and longing for meaningful work is reflection of our glory, a glorious and eternal God. Okay? So your desire, as you think about your career, okay, whatever that may be, and as you think about your responsibility, your gifts, the resources that you have, and all the ways that you're pouring that into other people, into this community, into this city, that's what we're considering work. Okay? You want it to be meaningful. And it's not simply hubris, okay, arrogance to say, yeah, I want my stamp, you know, to let, no, it's part of the way we're designed, because God is like that. His work endures, right? Kings and kingdoms go, but his kingdom will reign forever, Daniel says. God doesn't make something and then trash it and say, all right, let's start all over. No, he builds it. And it's here to stay. Now, sin comes in and thwarts all that and mars all that, but he repairs it in a glorious way. And so as you think about your work, the desire to leave something lasting, to make a difference in this city, it's not empty pride, but it really is what it means to be. It really made in the image of God. Psalm 90 is the only psalm written by Moses and was written towards the end of Israel's 40 years of wandering in the desert. And you may recall, for 40 years, Israelites wandered the desert until that generation that came out of Egypt perished because of their sin. And not just any sin, but it was sin of apostasy. Basically saying, God, thanks, but we got this. Let's go back to Egypt. Okay? It wasn't like they failed here and there and sinned the way you and I would sin, but it was basically rejecting God as their God. And wanting to go back to Egypt, which was slavery, back to a life of sin. Okay? So there's a difference between us as we fumble our way through eternity and glory than these people who said, thanks but no thanks. God, we got it figured out. And there Moses witnessed firsthand the vanity of homeless wandering and the tragedy of death, and it weighed heavily on his heart. And really, the first part of the psalm is just dark and depressing. But it doesn't end there. It really is a song of hope for those of us living in the desert. As we feel the pain of living life in a broken world, where what we do seems to mean not a whole lot. Moses comes and says, here, hear this song, hear this prayer. So there are two things that we want to look at. First, we want to look at a sigh in the desert and talk about the challenges of living life here on earth and the calling to create culture and the beauty in the desert. And we're going to wrap things as we talk about the beauty of Christ ultimately. Okay? A sign in the desert. Psalm 90 parallels Genesis 1 through 3 and provides commentary to the fall of man. As you recall, in Genesis 1, we read that God tames chaos and brings everything to order by speaking the universe into existence, and he creates man, fashions him out of dirt. Adam and Eve were given authority over the garden universe to reflect God's glory. How? Through work. Okay, let's park it there for a minute and think. They were called to reflect God's glory, not only in their nature and relationship, but through their work. And that calling still remains. Okay, we'll talk more about this later. And work is part of what we call culture. Sociologists and anthropologists have done extensive work on the subject of culture, and it's really one of the most complex and difficult concepts to understand because it covers so much. Okay, it covers so much. We have high culture, people who are rich, right? The 1%, they live a different world than we do, right? That culture is altogether different from us. And then you got pop culture, like, I don't know who's, well, K-pop, I mean, right? That's a different bubble altogether, right? I in my church, we got people who actually listen to K-pop. I'm like, what the, why do you listen to K-pop, you know? You are from Alabama. Like, what do you got? How is, you know, but they love K-pop. And they love Korean drama. And they'll say things like, oppa, baegeopa. You know, I'm like, this has gotten out of control. We need to tame this thing. By the way, I pastor a church of mostly Americans, white people. Sorry, I don't know if that's offensive. So I find these things to be, like, extremely different. I'm like, what? How do you know this, you know? We got pop culture, we got war culture, ethnic culture, we got sports culture. I mean, you know, where's that guy, you know, with the jersey? I mean, look, if you don't know anything about the world of sports, you're like, what is that? But if you know something about sports, you're like, yeah, what is that? Take that off, man, right? And each of these sub-worlds, if you would, subcultures, is highly nuanced. Right? It's highly nuanced. You don't simply read a book to understand it. You got to immerse yourself in it, right? I'm by birth, right, Korean. Yet I have no idea how to recycle trash. So some of you non-Korean sisters have to sort of spell it out for me, like, you do this, you do that. I'm like, I like America where you just dump everything in one, you know? Amen, sister. And let me offer this as a working definition for culture, okay? A culture is the expression of our humanity, okay? It's an expression of our humanity. So anytime you express yourself in any particular way, be it through writing, through art, through conversation, through sports, through work, through relationships, that's culture. And people buy into it, okay? And it sustains itself. Now, the ugly part of it is, even ugly culture sustains itself. I mean, look at the politics in America. And, you know, every year you got interns, you know, coming in with, you know, the sparkle in their eyes and, you know, with brand new shiny briefcase. Like, I'm going to change the world. You know, look out, D.C., here I come. And all of us who have been there, at least for a couple of years, were like, no. You just go get my coffee and sit in the corner and staple some paper. I mean, really, that's the extent of their work experience as interns, right? That system, let me just say this on a side note. Every system is created to protect itself, okay? It is perfectly tuned to produce the kind of results that it's getting. And it's been highly intentional. So for you to breathe into it, to bring change, it's not going to be easy. It takes a lot of work. And as a lot of the leadership folks, even outside of church, would say, especially for those of you in the mid-level management position, you got to walk into work. If you really want to see change, knowing that you could be fired, you got to risk it. That's the only way you can change. Anyway, I digress. Culture, in many ways, is layered. It's like an iceberg. The visible parts are music, art, language, food, literature, festivals, dress, so on and so forth. But the deep, submerged part of the culture is values, definition of beauty, body language, right? That will get you, especially if you know, if you have any Indian friends and they're doing this, you're like, what is that? I don't get it, you know? They're excited, in agreement with you, but it looks like they're totally disagreeing with you. So you're like, okay, all right, maybe we go back to the drawing board. Like body language, rules, expectations, assumptions, parenting styles, gender roles, all of this is the deep, okay, invisible part of the culture that we need to dive into to understand. And it really seems like a combination of many unrelated, disparate things coming together. But upon closer look, it really is our humanity. Okay? It's the expression of our intellect, our emotion, longing for relationship, okay, need for structure, governance, and all of that. And this aligns with what the Bible calls biblical anthropology. And let me hit this here, and we'll talk more about this later too. But this idea of sacred-secular divide has really done us a great disservice. Okay? God created Adam and Eve in a very fleshy way. Adam was a man. He had skin, blood, water running through his body, be it in a glorified state. But a lot of times, at some point, we have rejected all that. And we all know, right, the outside Gnostic thinking that crept in, saying the body's bad, the spirit is good, and the only way out of it is through secret knowledge and intelligence. But that really is nowhere to be found in the scripture. I mean, if you really want to understand the Bible's ultimate view on humanity, flesh and blood, you got to go to incarnation. Jesus came in flesh and blood. And he wasn't apologetic about it. He didn't have to repent of it. Okay? It was who he was, and it was beautiful. Okay. And so expressing ourselves, not just our intellect, not just our heart, but even the body, okay, that's part of our culture. In other words, we are made to. So God created us, fashioned us the way we are, so that as we live out our humanity, it becomes culture. It's expression of who we are. Okay, God made us that way and called us to be culture creators. Genesis 1, 26 to 28. And maybe this is for discussion question later in your small groups. Genesis 1, 26 to 28, talking about God creating Adam and basically giving him this cultural mandate. Okay. And what does it mean to be created in God's image? Does it stop at the spiritual? What do we do with the rest? And what does it mean to fill the earth and subdue it? Does it simply mean that we pray for it? Okay, we bust out our Bible tracts and condemn the world for not believing, or is there more? Okay, maybe you can discuss some of those things. But as we all know, something went horribly wrong. Okay, Genesis chapter 3. Adam and Eve committed a cosmic treason, which the Bible calls sin, and the entire creation became severely disfigured. And now we find ourselves living in a world filled with toil and trouble, Genesis 3 says, a mere shadow of Eden. We live outside of Eden. Okay? And Moses describes life outside of Eden as such, beginning with verse 5. He says, "You sweep them away as with flood. They're like a dream, like grass that is renewed in the morning. In the morning it flourishes and is renewed. In the evening it fades and withers." Talking about the temporariness of our humanity. And there's something really wrong with that. Death is a great anomaly. It should not be this way. Verse 7 through 9, "For we are brought to an end by your anger. By your wrath we are dismayed. You have set our iniquities before you, our secret sins in the light of your presence. For all our days pass under your wrath. We bring our ears to an end like a sigh." What a powerful imagery. Like a sigh. Right? Koreans do that. My mom does it all the time. You know, it's like, Like, that conveys so much. Like, I feel you, Mom. I feel you. Like, you don't have to articulate anything. Eesh. It's like, oh. You know, we end our life like that. And here in verses 10 through 11, Moses' concluding words, the years of our life are 70, or even by reason of strength, 80. Yet their span is but toil and trouble. They're soon gone and we fly away. Who considers the power of your anger and your wrath according to the fear of you? Moses basically is saying the tragedy, the ultimate tragedy of life is its brevity. We are not meant to die. Hence, the work we do is supposed to last. And we're supposed to enjoy the fruits of that work. Not just for 70, 80 years, but for rest of eternity. To celebrate our humanity expressed in tangible and not so tangible forms. To celebrate music. I mean, you hear Mozart and Chopin, it's beautiful. To celebrate that and say, wow, what creativity, what beauty. You look at nature. Well, DC, not a whole lot of nature. So look at nature, you know? All sorts of color, especially in this season. It's supposed to inspire awe in you, almost worship, not of nature, but of the one who created it and gifted to us. The wise teacher of Ecclesiastes summed it up well. He said, all is vanity. Why? Because nothing lasts. And those of you old enough to remember the band Kansas, you guys remember this song? All we are is dust in the wind. Anyone? Am I the only person? Okay, good. Thank you, sister. All we are is a dust in the wind. Okay? If Moses didn't get you depressed, Kansas certainly will. Here you go. They sing in the most melancholic way. Dreams pass before us. And not just the dreams we have at night, but the longing to see something beautiful, to do something with our lives. These grand dreams that are seated in our hearts, they pass away. Our work is just a drop of water in an endless sea. Yeah, there you go, right? How about that for, you know, self-esteem? It's like, you mean all my work? It's like, oh, what? That's it? All we do crumbles to the ground. Wow, that's a great thought. Nothing lasts forever. It slips away, dust in the wind. You know, it doesn't take a whole lot to be convinced of this. Especially if you're a parent, you understand that everything really is a dust in the wind. Every time I try to clean up after my kids, to have a clean house, it is a dust in the wind. You know, especially when you have four kids and now a puppy, right? Did Pastor Joel mention that? We got a fifth child, okay? Her name is Katie Lucy Park. She is not going back, okay? She has been incorporated, enfolded into our family with full membership. I mean, she's given the last name, the family name is Park. Four kids, 9, 7, 5, 3, and Katie is 6 months old. So trying to pick up after the kids is trying to manage a whirlwind as it goes, okay? And, you know, many Saturday mornings, you know, God bless my wife. She wakes up. She's like, oh, let's clean up our house. I want a clean house. All right. I know how this is going to play itself out. Like, okay, honey. And so we start from this part of the house. And by the time we get halfway, you see the whirlwind. It's like, you're like, oh, man. My three-year-old Daniel, to him, everything is a weapon. Everything is a gun. You know, even Katie shoots. I'm like, that's a dog. He's your sister. She's your sister. You don't use her as a dog. James. And then, you know, James has to retaliate. You got to fight fire with fire. So James will pull out and start launching grenades at him, which means leftover food sometimes. You know, it's like, what is the point? Vanity of vanities. All is vanity. What does a father gain by all the toil at which he toils under the sun? Absolutely nothing. Nothing. You know, the scripture, on a side note, let me say this. You know, as I get older and experience life, man, it is just so wise. It is, Man, I read Ecclesiastes as a young man. It's like all is vanity. Well, not really, you know, maybe some parts. Now, as a married man, father of five kids, all is vanity. Yes, all is vanity. Nothing lasts. Nothing lasts. And I go in the corner and it's woe is me, you know. And Moses mentions the reason why life is the way it is. In verse 8, he says, "You, God, you have set before us our iniquities, our secret sins in the light of your presence." And Paul picks up on this much later in the book of Romans 6:23 and says, "For the wages of sin is death." We did it to ourselves. Death, the great anomaly, is the consequence. It's the just consequence of sin. And, you know, I don't know if you've ever visited Washington, D.C., but there are a lot of monuments. You got the Washington monuments, Jefferson, Lincoln, and then tucked away in between you have, you know, all kinds of other people who have done great things, generals who have done great things. But all of these statues that line the streets of D.C., they are a constant reminder that no matter who you are and what you have accomplished on this side of eternal life, you can't cheat death. You can't. God did not intend things to be this way, but here's the good news. God will not leave things this way. When Christ walked out of the grave, he defeated sin and death and promised to return to finish what he started. You know what that means? For all those in Christ, all those who hold on to the promise that he will return, death has an expiration date. Death too will die. Pain and suffering, they don't get the last word. God does. And he has spoken his final word. And that word is Jesus. It's a word of hope, word of life, word of mercy. And Jesus, he also ended his earthly life with a sigh, did he not? The scripture tells us that he breathed his last. And if you understand that single fleeting moment on the cross, in light of Psalm 90, you realize what's going on. That he understood fully the temporary meaninglessness of life. That he faced death head on. And he said, "This is not good." And he did that so that all of us who place our faith and trust in him would never have to know the power of God's anger. Remember what Moses said? Who considers the power of your anger? Christ did on the cross. And if we place our faith in it, we never have to. And as Paul said, Romans 8, chapter 8, verse 1, "Therefore there is now no condemnation for those who are in Christ." This is the gospel, the good news. Which is a good segue into our second and final point. We'll try to pick up the pace here because, again, we want to cover a lot of ground. Second, the beauty in the desert. Desert, we said earlier, symbolizes not only the barrenness of life, but really the brokenness of sin. And in the desert, Moses came face to face with all that is horrible about life. His friends, people whom he led out of Egypt, dropping like flies. Yet in the midst of it here, Moses sees something that is so beautiful that it turns his heart to prayer, deep prayer and faith and trust in the Lord. And I think that's what harsh conditions of life outside of Eden does for us. It forces us to look for a Savior. And the idols come and they promise salvation. That's why they're so powerful. It's the alluring power of these promises. That if you place your faith in me, I will save you. And that's why they're so attractive. And we bow before these idols so all the time, really. But we all know, and you guys are old enough to know, that they're all broken, empty, meaningless promises. Tim Keller identified four core idols. And he talks about this regularly. He says, we have the core deep idols and the surface idols. The core idols that govern really our life. And even the trajectory of how we do life are power, control, comfort, and approval. Okay, power, control, comfort, and approval. Now, I don't know if this is like, you know, the gospel, but I think it's a helpful framework to understand and to exegete our own heart. Okay, when we exegete the text from the pulpit, like Pastor Joe would every Sunday, you as listeners, you need to exegete your own heart. Okay, why am I resisting this? Why am I not listening to this? You need to exegete those things. Why do I find this to be boring? Okay, you need to take it deeper and exegete your own heart. And I think it may come down to one of these. You've set your heart on something different, and the gospel has lost its beauty. It's the power that the world offers, the control that the world offers, comfort the world offers, the approval the world offers, has laid a hold of your heart. These idols promise to save us from our human plight, to put back together all the broken pieces of our lives. But Humpty Dumpty was right. Okay? It is theologically spot on. All the king's horses and all the king's men couldn't put Humpty together again. I read that, and every time I read it, I'm like, why are the horses trying it? Like, they're probably making it worse. Like, if you just had king's men, maybe, right? Maybe. But the horses, I don't know. They have hooves, and oh, there goes something. Sorry, neither can the idols really put our lives back together again. You see, life in the desert causes Moses to look to God in prayer. And beginning with verse 12, he prays. And let me just say a few words about prayer real quickly. You know, prayer, as I've said, we need piety. It's an important part of our faith. And I don't think we pray enough. And one of the things I love about the Korean church is their prayer life. As much as I could critique it from other side of the pond, can we even call it a pond? Maybe the ocean. And there are some things that I think need to be critiqued. But their devotion to prayer, I think, is something beautiful. And something we in the West, we need to emulate. We need the Korean church to disciple us, to teach us to pray. And I see my mom and her friends, those people who have committed to a life of fervent, devoted prayer, and I say that is something not only good, but it is beautiful, Christ-like. I cannot help but to read through the Gospel of Luke and say, Christ prayed all the time. And I think we, as God's people, we cannot use the gospel as get out of jail free card to say, I don't need to pray. I think, in fact, gospel calls us to pray even more so. It gives us all the more reasons to engage God in prayer with hope, not that our prayers, the amount of it or the fervency or the volume of it, is somehow going to get God's attention, but it's intimacy with God. And that is beautiful, isn't it? You read through passages like Mark chapter 1, verse 35, where Jesus early in the morning and got up and prayed. And we think, well, he needed, you know, to be an example. He needed power as no, I think he just wanted to be with the Father. It's the longing for intimacy that got up in the morning to say, I want to be with the Lord. I want to be with my daddy. And it's sad almost to see how so much of the dominant voices in the Western church have not been basically silenced in the name of the gospel. You read and study the life of the Puritans who have impacted and gave shape to the church now. They were men and women of prayer. Charles Spurgeon, one of my favorite theologians, he talks about prayer so much. I don't know if you've ever read his book on lectures to my students. And in chapter 2, he talks about prayer. And man, you cannot go more than a paragraph before you're like, I need to put this down and pray. E.M. Bounds, so much comprehensive work in prayer. A.W. Tozer in his work in prayer. I mean, so much work has been done in this area. And yet, we pick up the mantle of church in 21st century, and we sort of sift that out and say, nah. That's for the legalists. That's for those people over there. And we're not like that. We're gospel believing Christians. And I would say, no, I think we missed something. Anyway, I'll get off my soapbox here. But Charles Spurgeon said this. He said to preachers from generations ago, he said, your ministry of the word cannot exceed your ministry in prayer. How much time do we devote to studying, preparing, and preaching, and teaching the word? And even for Christians, how often do we do this to feed ourselves, to equip ourselves in the name of discipleship, and yet neglect to pray? I think we need to hear these words afresh, especially as we think about cultural engagement, because at the end of the day, it is not our wisdom or power that's going to change this world. I love Paul's words. In Corinth, city much like Seoul, maybe like DC, a city that prizes rhetoric, Paul says, the kingdom of God is not of words, but is of power. And he says, I came to you in weakness, not in fancy rhetoric to wow you with my wisdom, but I came to you humble, weak, broken, so that the power of the gospel may be displayed. I love that. Here in Moses' prayer, I mean, we could pick apart all of these things and they could be a sermon in themselves, but for the sake of time, let's park it at verse 17 and we'll pull from other verses. Okay, verse 17, let the favor of the Lord our God be upon us and establish the work of our hands. You see those correlation, that correlation there? Work and favor. Okay, we're going to unpack that. But for Moses, this was really important, especially in the desert, when they're not doing a whole lot of work. They didn't build monuments or cities. They didn't have institutions. They just walked. When the pillar moved, you packed your things and moved. That was it. Yet to him, it was so important. He says, let the favor of the Lord our God be upon us and establish the work of our hands. What work, Moses? What'd you do? And establish the work of our hands upon us. Yes, establish the work of our hands. The word favor is used elsewhere in the Bible to describe beauty, majesty, wisdom, and glory of God. You see what Moses is praying for? Let your beauty, your majesty, your wisdom, and your glory rest upon us. And God answers that prayer on Mount Sinai. Right? Moses goes up and says, let me see your glory. May your beauty rest upon me. And God says, I can't, because if I did, you will die. So cover yourself. Go hide in that crack. Cover yourself. I will pass, declaring my name. You guys piecing these things together? Favor, beauty, majesty, glory, wisdom, name. Okay? And if you're astute theologically, you know where we're going. I will declare my name, and you will see basically my behind. You know, we don't want to show our behind to anybody, but God's behind is so glorious that it transformed Moses, and it was so radiant that people said, Moses, you need to put something on, because it's like, oh my God, I can't see you. Whether you believe in God or not, and I don't assume that all of you are Christians here, whether you believe in God or not, you're longing for something beautiful. Your delight in something that is good, and your appreciation for what is true is an inkling, your longing for something much greater. C.S. Lewis talks about this. These things are basically like cookie crumbs on a trail that leads you to God Himself. When you see something so beautiful, a baby, a child, a puppy, whatever it is, and you adore it, you love it, you appreciate it, you celebrate it, it's your desire to be in worship of our God. To put it differently, every expression of earthly beauty is a window into God, a shadow of the real thing. And, you know, like I said, we have this puppy, and everywhere I carry her, you know, they don't even see me. Like, no one ever sees me, and I'm thankful for that. They see the puppy, they're like, oh my gosh. And I'm like, what? That's weird. Like, you know, you get all like that in front of another man, you know? It's like, I'm here too, you know? I'm not comfortable with this, you know? You're reaching out for what is part of me, you know? But they don't care. They're like, oh! And I'm like, what the? But this default automatic response to something that is beautiful, I think it really says something about our heart. It's a creational design. It's our love for it and appreciation of God, okay? Moses prays, remove our shame and guilt and cover us with your beauty, right? So in the verses preceding verse 17, he says, remove our shame and guilt and cover us with your beauty so that our temporal activities, our work, will basically reflect your eternal work. That's what he's praying here, okay? And again, what work did Moses pray about? Because they didn't really do a whole lot besides walk, okay? Moses prayed for his future generation, the work that we'll be doing in the promised land, in building a nation, a city, the temple, for God to come. Because you see, the Old Testament mission strategy was come and see the glory of God. Even the location itself. Basically, what is the biggest highway in Korea here? Like, what would be, can you tell me the biggest highway?
Olympic.
Olympic Highway? Yeah, imagine if you set up a city right in the middle of that highway. People are going to notice. What is that doing here? And then you go out and say, hey, come, see the beauty of our God. What do you mean? Come, see the beauty of God. You see, our God is such and such. And you roll out the Ten Commandments. And if you study the Ten Commandments, obviously it's a moral code, how we need to act in covenant relationship with God and with one another. But it's got a missional component altogether. Do not murder. We say, oh yeah, we shouldn't murder. You know what that meant in a world where they killed whoever they wanted to possess whatever they wanted? They're weak. They're on the margins of the society. No one would even know if we went and killed them and took their property. No, our God says every person, regardless of their social status, is important. Why? Because we're all made in the image of God. Wow. So you actually value every single person, even those who can't contribute to your society. Yes. Those on the margins, the people we would consider to be invisible people, yes, they're all important. Oh my gosh, I want to know this God. You see, it's got a missional component. And Moses is praying that their life in the promised land would be such that the nations will come and say, teach us about your God. All the things the prophets wrote about, that nations will come to Mount Zion to hear of the Lord. That's what Moses is praying for. That their work, which is not just spiritual, right? They're not just praying in their homes out there, but it's physical work. The temple was very much physical, okay? Sacrifice was very much physical. All of these things pointed toward the greatness of God in bringing the nations under his submission. Lord, establish the work of our hands, your people, that the nations will hear about you and see your kingdom modeled, to bring about true peace, shalom, that our hearts ache for. That's what he's praying. How does this happen practically? Through our work. Okay, we're going to try to bring all this together, okay, and talk about work and the importance of your work, and not just your career, but really utilizing your gifts and resources to pour into the common good of the people here in this community, especially, as Paul says, but all the more out in the city too. How does this happen? Through our work. Again, it's not just our career, but it's everything we do. Spurgeon once again said, work and divine beauty at first glance, how different. Okay? Work. Just think about your work. A lot of you teach English, and you feel like you're making no headway, right? What the? That's, it's like, right? Just think about that work. Some of you stay-home moms, think about the diaper you're changing at 2 in the morning. You're not even sure if you put it on the right way, okay? Because you're half asleep yourself. I know. I've been there, okay? I actually one time put it on the wrong kid. I put it on. What do you mean? He was wet. Oh, James, why do you have the diaper? Daniel should have the diaper. I know. Just think about your work, okay? And others of you who do different lines, just think about your work. And this divine beauty, majesty, glory of God, they seem to be so divided, right? Worlds apart. Spurgeon says, yet on deeper insight, how truly one, how inseparably united. You know what he's talking about? The world will catch on to the glory, the beauty, the majesty of God through our work, because this remains behind a veil. But this, it's right where they are. It's through your creativity, your wisdom, your hard work, your commitment, your love, your passion for it. Not so that you can get up as high as you can, as fast as you can, but even in the midst of that, to put others before you, to humbly serve, to remember a name, to be patient with that person who can never remember their vocab, right? In the way we go about our work, we declare that the kingdom not only is coming one day, but it's actually here already. And behold, the kingdom of God. Mako Fujimura, one of my favorite artists, he's an elder at an evangelical church in New York, world-renowned artist. This is what he said. He said, God uses our work as a vehicle to create the world that ought to be. Let me say that again. God uses our work. Just think about your work. God uses your work as a vehicle to create the world that ought to be. This means, okay, our work at all levels, not just pastors, missionaries, doctors, nonprofit folks, okay, but work at every level extends the border of Eden by mediating God's beauty, okay, justice, love, and hope in this world. You see, let me put a bow in this, okay? God's beauty then is created. God's beauty is created in tangible ways. It is refined, given shape, and displayed in our city and community through our relationships with people, the community that we have together, we are called the body of Christ, and our work. Some of the people that you work with will never come into this community to see for themselves the beauty of Christ. But you have the opportunity to take that beauty and shape it, fashion it in your work. And you can demonstrate the beauty for them. And some of you might say, well, I live and work in a business sector where things are kind of sketchy, lines blurred. I don't know how all this works. I get it. You know, we got a lot of politicians in my church. Senator Tim Scott from South Carolina, the first African American senator, comes to our church whenever he's in town. And we hear it. You know, I have somewhat of a briefing with, a bunch of congressmen and the heads of their committees and so forth, talking about this stuff. And the questions they raise, it's not simple. It's complex. It's nuanced. And you got to be able to wade into that and figure out how do we debunk this, first of all, pick it apart, and infuse gospel health in a timely manner so you celebrate victories incrementally, because that's the end picture. That's where we want to get. But we got to do this first. And is that a compromise? I don't think so. So you got to be all that stuff. Let me say that. We live in a world where it's not a beeline from A to B. Our good work, kingdom demonstrated. Our good work, gospel. No, it's a web, okay? And it is intricate. What you do here might echo here and might miss that. You wanted to get, you're like, God, my coworker. And then someone else is like, oh, my life was changed. What? Okay, let's try it again. Bam. Oh, my life. Thank you. wow, what you said there was so insightful. It saved my marriage. Great. But I was trying to reach this person and their marriage. And pastors see this firsthand, right? We preach a message and we're like, man, that was a dud. You know, it's like, oh gosh. And then people are like, that changed my life. You're like, what? No, right? No, seriously? No, it changed my life. Okay. We live in a world where we're all connected in an intricate and complex web. So what you do as you try to reflect the gospel, the beauty of Christ here and there, might never make it to where you want it to go. But if we do all our part, somehow that's being done. So let me say this. For you teachers teaching English, being patient with your student and loving them well in that context, that's one of the best ways for you to love your non-Christian neighbor. How? It's interconnected. Stay home moms, as you pour into your bratty little kid, that's what I call my children, evil incarnate, as you pour into them, love them, disciple them, and raise them up in the ways of Christ, you are loving your next door neighbor, atheist, non-Christian. How? We live in a web. But we know that whenever the gospel is preached, that word does not come back void, the Bible promises. But it is working out his plan. Okay? So let me encourage you with those words. Oh my gosh, I have like three more pages. I can't do this. Let me skip. Okay. I'll end with this thought. The beauty, the majesty, glory, the favor of God is tied to a name, and that name we know is Jesus. He is the glory of God. And the prayer that Moses prayed in thinking about his future generation, Lord, let your beauty rest upon us, that through us, that the nations will see you, was answered most vividly on the cross. May your beauty rest upon us, and the beauty, the glory that was displayed in the suffering servant who humbly went to the cross to say, here I am. His death once and for all marked our history, so that when we look to the cross and understand it with eyes of faith, that our lives are never the same again. It's that beauty resting upon us. And now that beauty of Christ, his mercy, his grace resting upon us, gives meaning and focus to our work. It's no longer for a paycheck to get up, you know, to another level so we can manage more. No, it's wherever God has called me right now, this is my joy, my privilege to reflect Christ, the humble, suffering servant, so that his beauty will be lived out in me as I learn to be humble, as I learn to be patient, as I learn to put others before me. The fullness of God's beauty is Christ, and that beauty now rests in us. And we as God's people must respond not with, okay, well, it's done. No, we respond with, as Paul said, by giving ourselves fully to the work of the Lord. Because we know that our labor in the Lord is not in vain. That he uses our work not only to contribute to the common good of the people living in our community and in our city, but he uses our work to demonstrate the beauty of Christ himself.